But at this particular time, I'd want to invite our second speaker, who is Professor Ruth, who will be taking us through the place of Indigenous knowledge and women, smallholder farmers in food systems as a pathway to tackling food and nutrition security in Kenya. Professor, you have a wealth of knowledge. Kindly share with us, Professor Oniang'o. You have some 10 minutes.
Thank you, Professor Julius. You know, you've given me 10 minutes. And Nancy followed me. Everybody keeps pulling me from retirement. And she just said, Prof, you have to come here. Then she sends me 2 pages of issues to address. So I say, Nancy, I'll just come because you never retire from food issues. You know, so long as there's a hungry child somewhere, so long as there are 2 million Kenyans going hungry, almost starving, you never retire from these issues. And then you can also learn from the young people that are coming up and encourage them. And you can also share what you have learned, a bit of what you have learned, with the others. So if you want any more, you just Google me and see some of the things I've said in the past. And so I'm just here to encourage you, Julius. Yeah, I know I have 10 minutes. What's my connection with the Netherlands? I'm not an alumnus, but I remember, recommending students to go to Wageningen, to do food security courses, some of them to do, a mastery, to do PhDs and so on. But I've also worked with the Dutch researchers, here in Kenya. Long-term research projects, and I've also been funded. My work on dairy, women owning dairy animals in Western Kenya, that work has been funded by the Royal Dutch Embassy. So I'm grateful, and I'm really very excited that we have a country which funds, follows up its students, once they graduate and come back to their countries. And when I've spoken even internationally, I've always said, look, with all these issues of corruption, issues of governance, issues of integrity, you countries where our African students have come to you and studied in your countries, follow them up with some resources, with some funding, so they can do projects. And you saw the ambassador of the Netherlands talk about how far they have come and where they are now and what they are doing. And they want to see how some of that can actually be, repeated here on the continent or adapted, So I think it's absolutely critical for those of you who are participants here. Most of you, I know every one of you is much younger than myself, that you really have a great opportunity. These partnerships, especially through the Sustainable Development Goals. Now, coming to what Nancy really wanted me to talk about, the women. I am an academic. At senior lecturer level, I was getting bored. And when I left the US to come to Kenya, I said, I'm going to get Africa, rid Africa of all malnutrition and hunger. And when you travel, what do you see of Africa? Starving children, refugees moving from where to where, no good picture of Africa, our mother continent. And this is the richest continent on earth. This is the cradle of mankind. How can you be proud of this? And really, I started to ask myself, what will be my legacy? And fortunately, I got Dutch funding to go back to where I came from, to Western Kenya, to find out what ails us. And it was a sugarcane growing area. All the foods, that diversity was already gone. And truly, Chair, I discovered it were the women who were toiling away on tired soils, not good harvests, little information. The men are either in some shopping center talking away, nothing politics, or they have left the villages. And how could we be food secure in Africa when everything is on the backs of these women, who can hardly feed their families? And so that's how I started to say, I didn't study agriculture. I didn't study toiling. I was a mathematician. I was a scientist. I was to be a medical doctor, But you know what? In the end, I studied nutrition, and food is the first medicine. And the corona event right now proves us correct, that all of a sudden, nutrition is so key because it feeds our immunity. It protects us. The foods we eat is not just about maize, you know, starches, and so on. It has to be diverse. Our diets have to have more fruits and vegetables than we do starches. And so for me, nutrition all of a sudden becomes so critical. And who plays that role, especially? It is the women. Who has the information on the foods that we have locally? It is the women, you know, and we need to support them. But I can tell you that as I've worked on this all along, I found out that it's just become a buzzword. Women, youth. I hardly see any men around here who are malnourished. But I see women toiling away, feeding these men, feeding everybody but themselves, you know? So we focus on the women. We need to educate them as well. They don't need to be literate to do well. And really, we also need to understand why smallholder farmers do not take the knowledge the way we give it to them. You cannot understand it unless you are on the ground. So I want to appeal to us academics. I remember when I now went to the ground, my colleagues used to laugh at me. Ruth, what are you doing? Are you looking for a political office? You will never publish your work. Lo and behold, I'm now a publisher. I publish people's works, you know? And where do their work come from? Where does that knowledge come from? It can only come from the ground, from the research you have done. But you can do research and at the same time, inform as you do that. We have to humble ourselves that we have indigenous knowledge. Our people know, even if they can't add 1 + 1 = 2, they know they have lived in those situations. What has corona shown us? That we are going back to our indigenous situation. Regenerative agriculture is just a word. People are telling, oh, Ruth, regenerative agriculture. And I say, what is that? Fallow farming we used to do, intercropping we used to do, using manure from our animals we have always done, making sure we do, you know, fallows and we do terraces to protect soil against soil erosion we have always done. So there is information already amongst us in our communities, even which the Western world can learn from. So I believe in a hybrid system where we actually merge modern technology. How does it fit with our indigenous knowledge? And how can we actually make good use of it for sustainability? Look, climate issues have affected us. Everybody knows that now. So we are dealing with corona, the pandemic, at the same time we are dealing with the climate issues. How do we move forward? How we get resources? And how do we get our governments to understand this word that agriculture is the cradle of our economy? You know, the mainstay has been there since I worked on the very first food policy in this country, donkey years ago. Some of this is just the same. And that's why I believe that for young people, passing the message on to you, is that the answers are there. The answers are there. The responsibility is ours. We should say no to seeing malnourished African children on television, in the media. It is scandalous. We should be ashamed of it. But you know, we can do a lot even at our own personal level. I don't wait for funding. I don't even get a lot of funding either, but I am there on the ground and we can design. We are academics, yes. We can, and they require us, imagine even up to now, they say publish or perish. I have a student of mine, I was asking her yesterday, why aren't you a professor yet? She has done so much. She tells me, Prof, I haven't graduated a PhD student. I said, my foot. I haven't graduated a PhD student. I have to have graduated a PhD student for me to be recognized, to be given professor ranking. Look here, even universities need to change. They are so archaic. They are so archaic, you know, they are like the Catholic Church. Nothing ever changes. And we have the wherewithal to change, determine our own destiny, and do better, feed us, and feed the rest of the world. That's all I'll say for now. Prof, I put my email there. People can contact me if they want. If you have a paper you want to publish, we are very strict. We are internationally indexed. But look, I want to urge us. We have a beautiful continent called Africa. We have a beautiful country called Kenya. I've been to Tanzania. We have the customs union. The trading doesn't even happen properly. The regulations are there. But you know, someone stops your truck full of food, which is going to perish, which is going to go bad. Food safety is key. And also collaborating with the private sector is key. So Prof, I'll leave it there. But look, just join on to the UN Food Systems Summit because it talks about partnerships. Let's thank our partners. Let's thank our sponsors. Let's thank the Netherlands government and any other. Let's implore on our Kenyan government, on our governments. It should not just be agriculture is the mainstay of the economy. Put resources where your mouth is. Put resources where your words are. Thank you. I want to really wish you a great conference, and we'll continue talking.
Thank you, Professor, for those words. Actually, they are so encouraging and challenging at the same time, challenging the academia. There's the issue of publish or perish. There's the issue of all those criteria that have been put in place, whereas so many people have done a lot, but they cannot get such promotion. Thank you for bringing that into light. I've also liked one of the sentiments as I keep on listening to in YouTube and other forums, where you say that the hungriest are the smallholder farmers and they are the producers. That's something we need to think about. Thank you for that.